Hello, CUBE community, and welcome back to Black Hat 2025 at Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm Jackie McGuire, practice lead and principal analyst for security, also your favorite security media host, and I am joined by Ted Shorter. Ted, welcome. Ted is the CTO and co-founder of Keyfactor. Thanks for being here, Ted.
Great to be here.
Yeah. So let's start with a little bit of your background. You're a co-founder, so I would love to hear, you know, kind of where you started in technology and then how you ended up at a place where you decided you needed to start a company to solve a problem.
Yeah, I never really set out to start a company. So I spent 10 years working for a government three-letter agency right
Alphabet
out of college.
Alphabet, nice.
where I got the vast majority of my cryptography and security background.
Okay.
And left there, and in 2003 joined a small kind of boutique consulting company. We were doing a lot of work around identity management at the time, a lot of PKI design and deployments, especially like organizations dealing with a newly mobile workforce needed internal PKI, right? So mm-hmm. the corporate ID badge versions as opposed to the driver's license or passport version. But we kept seeing the same unmet needs over and over again. Mm-hmm. These things that we would set up for our customers would fail every, after 2 years or so for the same two reasons. And we kept waiting for a vendor to fill that space and no one did. So, started by writing a small tool that sort of snowballed into what Keyfactor does today.
Awesome. So, and what are the two reasons?
Now that I have my own PKI, I can issue many certs as I want and I'm not paying anybody per certificate. I have a certificate management problem at a scale that no one had seen before. So truly scalable certificate management. And then the other part was just keeping the expertise in-house. So we'd train these people in the consulting engagements, and then they would get promoted or leave the company or, in some cases, got laid off, and then these things would just crash and burn over time. And we just got tired of seeing it, and so we're like, okay, let's just run it for you, and we'll manage all the certs, we'll run that whole thing for you, and that's really where that started. We made some other acquisitions and other technology along the way, but that really led to what we do today.
Yeah, not to make too much of a play on words, but I do think there's a lot of key person risk in security that we don't necessarily
A lot of bus factor, as they say.
Dude,
yeah.
I say that all the time. I'm always like, what if they get hit by a bus? And everybody's like, whoa, that's a little extreme.
Or win the lottery. You can say that. That sounds better.
What if they win the lottery? What if they move out of the country? But it's definitely something I think is a huge, there are so many, I've never been in an enterprise for any amount of time where there wasn't a person, I shouldn't say guy, because we say person now. There wasn't a person who was the only person who could do something that was important.
Yeah.
And that's, it's a huge
risk. I think, honestly, that's a lot of the driver behind the as a service, whatever it is, as a service. It's as much about, and certainly PKI as a service is as much about the not having to have as much expertise in-house than it is about cloud or offloading workloads or whatever. It's about not having to have that expertise. Let your experts focus on stuff that's more core to the business.
Yeah, so explain a little bit more, if I'm like a fifth grader, what Keyfactor does and how you bring that expertise.
Yeah, so today that's called what's now called machine identity management. So really it's machines, devices, workloads, it's anything that needs an identity, both in the enterprise and in the IT space. So about 70% of our business is in the large enterprise. That's identities for web servers, workloads, Kubernetes clusters, mobile phones, that sort of thing. The 30% actually is more interesting. It's at least to me, it's the medical devices, planes, trains, automobiles, people making things that need identities so that, when they phone home or get a firmware update, they know that it's legitimate. So.
Medical is something that keeps coming up over and over. And
it's important.
I think you're probably the third or fourth person that's mentioned security and in healthcare today. And I just keep thinking about, we have this massive population of baby boomers who's going to be onboarding into a pretty intense, need for medical care and services and things like that. Sure. And our ability to scale that is not anywhere close to where it needs to be able to both serve all of those people and protect all of the things that are serving all of those people.
Yeah, for sure. And of course, all these things are connected now, right? So like any other industry that's making things, it's all connected, right? So, and if you think about, if you're updating firmware on a pacemaker when it's attached to someone, you better make sure you're protecting the private keys to that update.
you need to patch your defibrillator.
It's the kind of thing that people can make movies about, right? So, yeah, it's super important. You know, like a lot of things, the first generation of some of the, you know, connected devices, almost any connected device, often didn't take security as seriously. They wind up being presented at Black Hat or something else, not of their own accord, and then you know, get much better after that when they realize.
You mean I shouldn't
important.
Be able to hack your blood sugar monitor with my flipper?
Yeah, well, at least that's mostly that's read only, right? It's yeah. not, you know, your insulin yeah. pump's probably more important.
Yeah, yeah, this is very true. Yeah. This is very true. So, I mean, we have to talk about agentic AI I will say though that Black Hat last year, it was mostly security people being like, keep this stuff out of my organization. We're just going to put policies in place to ban it. Like, and I've said this multiple times, so our audience is sick of hearing it, but the horse is out of the barn.
Yep.
Like, we're not putting that horse back in the barn. So I think there is some kind of resolve now in the security that's like, okay, we can't stop this. So now a lot of people are, okay, but how do we get to a place where, and I think this is one of my working theories, is agentic AI will actually be one of the things that helps repair some of the relationship between security and the rest of the organization.
Interesting.
Because that, from my perspective, that's always kind of been one of the big blockers, is that security's always been the department of no, the department of you can't do that, and we can't really be that anymore. And so security's going to have to kind of change to the department of, hey, we saw you did this thing, we've got your back, we just wanted you to know a few things. And I think everybody's real desire to use agentic AI is going to push that. So when you think about things like keys and thinking about managing identity and the ability of agents to almost instantaneously do 100 different things, how do you start to even try to get your hands around that or understand the first things you should be thinking about?
Yeah, no, I mean, you're absolutely right. So I think, you know, like cloud and even to me, the best parallel, I'm old enough now to many viewers may not be old enough, but I remember when the internet first happened, and
I still remember my ICQ number.
Okay, so you know, and it was very much. I really do believe that agentic AI and AI in general is going to be as transformative at the end of the day as the internet was. Mm-hmm. It's going to change the way people live and work in a very profound sense, and we're only at the very, very beginnings of that. We're at, you know, what the internet was in 1994, and
it's a pretty gnarly place to be.
Well, and so it was the same sort of thing. Like the benefits are undeniable. So mm-hmm. it's coming. It's, you know, you just it is going to happen. Much like the early internet, not very secure.
It's interesting too, thinking about the full cycle we've been through, from the never put anything about you on a bulletin board that's real. Like, we all use usernames, to you have to give Facebook your actual real name and your driver's license
to verify.
Don't put anything on the internet.
Yeah.
So.
But by the same token, like, I remember, like, the early days of the internet, I remember being deathly afraid of entering a credit card number into a website.
Yeah.
And probably justifiably so, but at the time. But I also was perfectly fine reading my credit card number to a stranger over the phone.
Because
that's how you bought stuff.
Or so letting them do the thing with the machine.
Yeah, with the carbon. Yeah. So there's lots of, you know, anything new, there's going to be lots of insecurity. But I think, to me, you know, I also very much think, I'm a big fan of MCP, Model Context Protocol.
Yes.
It is, to me, kind of game-changing in that it allows applications and software to do what they're good at, mm-hmm. and not have to worry about building models into everything. I mean, certainly there are cases where you would still want to do that, but you don't automatically have to AI, you know, every application.
Yeah.
You can let the application do what it does well, and then let let AI do what it does well, and separate those two things so they can innovate at their own pace. I think, you know, the other part to me, much like zero trust, it does come down to identity, right? You need to know what this thing is. You need to know what it's supposed to do. So it starts with identity that's strong and well established and durable. And then you need fine grain access control, so you can actually say in a much more explicit sense than we've gotten away with doing with people exactly what you. I mean, there are lots of software that has good RBAC and so forth, where you can say, like, you're allowed to do this with this thing and not with that thing, and you can do this for this person but not for this person, and all that sort of thing. So I think, you know, getting that to a granularity you know, you can really carve out exactly what you're allowing this AI agent to do and what you don't want it to do. And then
without impacting its ability to return value.
So fine-grained exactly what you want it to do and nothing more. And then I think the other part is audit and auditability and being able to watch what's happening and then alert and remove access if it does somehow go off the rails. But you know, it all starts with identity.
And how can Keyfactor help?
So we do, like, you know, we do machine identity, we do workload identity, we do identity for you know other workloads, you know, Kubernetes clusters and other automatic processes and so forth. So clearly that's a piece of it. I think when it comes to agentic AI, you know, MCP is a little early on the standards as far as that goes. Most of the implementations have OAuth support, which is a great start. Mm-hmm. A lot of them though are just using like fixed app keys.
You know, we just saw a horrific data breach because of an app using fixed keys.
So like we got to get better. I mean, it's great for testing and trialing, and that's, you know, most of our customers are very large enterprise. Most of the folks I talk to, they're testing, they're playing around. There's not a ton of it in production, mm-hmm. but everyone is telling me that's going to change in 3-4 months. Like mm-hmm. it's not, you know, they're, you know, holding it off for a little bit, but it's not, you know, going to happen forever. But I'm hoping that the standards come around and we can use some of the same sorts of identity technologies, things like digital certificates and keys and so forth, that can be changed out and are more secure and properly vetted and all of that to establish that that strong identity, because that everything else hinges on that, right? Yeah. At least in our view.
And if you are CTO, CISO, one of the things that I always like to ask people in C-level is, if you're explaining this to your executive committee, who really doesn't understand what a PKI is or what an agent is, and they just have heard the buzzwords, how do you explain to them in layman's terms what the real risk is and why they need to write a check because you need to address this risk?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, luckily, I mean, I guess part of the explanation, I don't know if it's lucky or not, but you know, there are certainly already plenty of stories of well-trained AI kind of going off the rails unexpectedly and deleting databases and
just dropping SQL tables,
whatever. Yeah, and so, you know, I think some of that will will hopefully resonate. When I think about the identity piece, you know, even going back to the internet, I actually do believe that MCP will likely, in some ways, sort of become the HTTP of the internet. Mm-hmm. You know, I think every piece of software will have an MCP server within 6 to 12 months.
I hope so.
We launched one of our own a few months ago, and are launching the rest of the product line very soon. It's interesting though; it's the HTTP of the internet, not the HTTPS.
Yes, yeah.
and in some ways that parallel kind of holds. Like the early days of the internet, nobody really thought about security. The internet was not encrypted.
And
we forget that now, because now you just sort of assume everything is. But I think, you know, we need that same sort of mindset of like, how are we really going to secure this thing? It's great to get these great use cases going. I think there's tremendous power. I think there's no question that AI is going to change the world. In the same way that the internet did, if not even more so. But we have to get the security right, or it's going to be a hot mess.
I mean, things with agents happen virtually instantaneously. So it's, if we don't get this right the first time, we're not going to find out about it until something's gone really wrong, because it happens almost instantly.
And to me, the idea of having a person like watch over it—it's happening too fast. It does the right thing for, you know, 5 days on end. You're not going to pay that much attention to it. And so I think you need automated oversight, as well, for sure. I think it's interesting too. You know, AI. There's also a lot of cases where, you know, you can give your credentials to a model and let it go do things. And delegate the credentials through, but which is sort of like, you know, if you want to think of an AI as being like a person, it would be like having an intern and actually giving them your password and asking you to do something, as opposed to giving them their own password and then giving them access, which is what
and then only giving them access to the thing
that
they
need. Which goes back to me, that's the right way to do it. It needs its own identity, and then you decide what it's allowed to do or not do based on who it is or what it is.
Well, Ted, thank you so much. This has been great. I wish we had more time. Unfortunately, we are running short on it, and I'm sure you have 100 other things to do at Black Hat this week. Really appreciate it. Would love to have you back to talk more.
I'd love to as well. Yeah. So thank you.
Yeah. All right. Stay tuned. We will be back from Las Vegas, Nevada at Black Hat 2025 with more coverage and guests.